John Chapman began a career in fire in the early 1950s on the St. Joan National Forest, now part of the Panhandle National Forests. From there, he went to the Lolo National Forest. As a crew boss, John traveled throughout the West, supervising hand crews on countless fires, large and small. John says that the first time he went on fire, there were no radios, and so people just had to be aware of what was going on. A passion for watching how fires burned led him into fire behavior prediction, a profession he remained in until retirement. Here, at age 75, John shares his thoughts about why crew members' observations are vital to fire behavior predictions and briefings.
I went on to California when I was still on the St. Joe, and when I just first became sector boss qualified. Towards the end of the season, we got sent to California, a bunch of us, just as miscellaneous overhead. And while I was down there, I was assigned a bunch of Marines to suppress the fire with. And a guy by the name of Forrest Winch also went down with me. And he had the night shift, I had the day shift. And we passed on the line going up, and he told me not to go, that we were going to be at risk and that we shouldn't go up there today. That during the night he had a lot of problems. They didn't get much line constructed. They spent a lot of time flattening off the top of the mountain with dozers. And he told me that we were going to have trouble. And in fact, we got overrun that day. And thanks to his forethought and his knowledge of fire behavior, we were able to pass the day and come off there intact. Yeah, that's what got me interested in what fire was doing and how it behaved and why it did the things it did.
In the absence of models, early in his career as a fire behavior analyst, John used the tools at hand, or he adapted them to make them useful.
On Mortar Creek, I was able to pull some stuff off the computer here on the forest of the weather stations around the salmon there, and so I had some idea what was going on, and based on my experience in the Doug Fir Ponderosa types, that I had some feel for what was actually going on before I got there. But my first shot on a lot of the fires was with the numbers, because that's basically what you had, either whether you got them out of the fire danger rating system or you did them with your calculator. They were based on basically what somebody told you the types were that you were burning in. And it works, you know, if you know what the fuel models are, you can come up with reasonable numbers.
John's main interest was in those parts of the fire where extreme fire behavior might be expected. His predictions, after the first one, were always grounded in truths with crews who had been on the line that day.
What I asked them was what went on out there, because and what was burning, and what kind of activity throughout the day. When was the extreme fire behavior? And so that gave me some idea. In other words, some habitat types, some vegetation burns earlier in the day, and others, various aspects, burns later in the day. Mm-hmm. And so it helps to know where that switchover is. Mm-hmm. And so as you change from fuel model to fuel model, from aspect to aspect, there's a difference in burning period. I'd do it standing in the chow line, mm-hmm. or waiting to wash, or wherever I ran into these guys. Sometimes I'd catch them as they were coming off the line before they even got to take mm-hmm. their showers. And just quiz them as we passed on, just casual type conversation. It wasn't an organized thing.
Why do fire behavior analysts want to talk to field-going crew members? Because their experience on the line can validate or question fire behavior prediction.
I would ask them how it went today. Just casually ask that. And then I would ask them, where was the biggest problems for you, fire suppression-wise? Did you lose line? Why did you lose line? Is it because the fire was just so intense it crossed your line, or because it spotted over your line, which is a different piece of information you need to have. If it's radiation, then they just didn't cut the line wide enough. If it's a spotting problem, then it's the type of vegetation that they're being involved with and the dryness of it that's suddenly become the fore rather than radiation. If I hadn't predicted that kind of spotting, then one of the questions I would ask the person I was interviewing is, what's burning? Is it subalpine fir? Is it ponderosa pine? What type of trees are torching out, or what kind of shrubs are torching out? And that gives me some idea of what to change in the briefing tomorrow. If it's the shrubs that are torching out and spotting, it's the leaves that are doing it. If it's ponderosa pine, then it's probably the needles and small branch wood and cones that are causing the problem. If it's subalpine fir, it's probably just the large number of needles that are being lofted and small bits of wood that are going across. And so gives me some idea the type of spots that they should be looking for with their patrols that are out there looking for spot fires. It also gives me an indication of how many they should be worried about. And whenever I see subalpine fir or alpine fir, I know there's potential for spotting, simply because the branches go all the way to the ground, and so any surface fire you have is going to run under there, and it's going to go vertically. And so whether it's a small fire or a large fire, you're going to have a spotting problem if you're in and around subalpine fir. Same way with Doug fir, but not near that to that extent if the branches go all the way to the ground. Well, and a lot of your Doug fir, your ponderosa pine, your branches aren't, unless it's open grown, aren't all the way to the ground. They're up there somewhere.
John coupled the information from crew members with his own observations to form a fire behavior prediction that would be useful.
I spent a lot of time during the shift out in the field, and so I was able to come back and talk in terms of what I actually saw. And then in conjunction with that from other sections of the line that I might not have been able to get to, I was able to put some verbal stuff together that in Sector D or Division A, this is the way it burned today. Tomorrow, because the higher moisture conditions, you're going to have less activity, you're going to have creeping, smoldering fire, and you aren't going to have the normal 10 to 11 o'clock shift, or you're on the reverse slope and your fire activity isn't going to get in there, start in there, until the sun crests the top of the ridge.
John's message to field-going personnel is that by observing and communicating your observations, fire behavior predictions can continue to become more accurate.